I also wanted to listen to the song. No, the reason why we changed it up, man, we started that series last week, and it's going to be for the next 5 weeks, and it's called Mental Health. How is your mental health? You know what I'm saying? The armor of God. But before we do that, welcome to the First Heavy Metal Church of Christ. I'm Brian Smith. If you're watching or listening for the very first time today, please check us out at heavymetalchurch.com. Look us up on Facebook under the First Heavy Metal Church of Christ. We have a YouTube page under Heavy Metal Church, Instagram under Heavy Metal Church. And yeah, check us out. Give us a like, follow us. We'd love to have you a part of this misfit family. But let's dive in here. What time is it, Pinky? 12:44. All right. This is a good jump. Before I get started, man, today has just been so weird. I really believe. See, I'll start reading here in a minute, but God's given me a revelation, man. I believe it. I don't ever say stuff like that. You know, I mean, he gave me a revelation about this church. He gave me, you know, he speaks to me in weird ways. Ideas will just drop in my lap. And this morning, and between yesterday morning and this morning, it just hit me on something that I've always been kind of confused about. I mean, everybody, I'll just go in and go for it. It's self-explanatory. This is week two of the Full Armor of God series, and it's based on Ephesians 6:10-20. And also, it is our official scripture of Heavy Metal Church. Now, most people don't understand or even realize that even the name of our church alone has a hidden meaning. Seriously, it was designed like that. The name alone is a Trojan horse that will get us to certain events that other churches with traditional names couldn't. You know, it's like, it's nothing to go have our bus or something like that down at Rip Rap Roadhouse or the Villa Tavern or something and just doing our thing, you know. And I'm not cracking on that. We have been called to do something a little different. Well, a lot different. But you know, a lot of other, a regular church bus or something like that, a lot of hellraisers, I mean, and would run from that and not want anything to do with it. We've seen it time and time again. But by our name alone, now people automatically assume that Cannibal Corpse or Gwar handles our worship music every Sunday. And now, don't get me wrong, yes, we have different bands every week, and some are considered heavy metal, but we also bring in blues, contemporary, and you know, just a little bit of everything. What would you guys consider yourself today? Groove metal. I love that, dude. I'm serious. He grooves, too, don't he? I mean, you should have seen him bonging five monsters back there. What is that, the water bongs or the beer bongs? Yeah, he was bonging monsters back there. I'm just kidding, you guys rock, man. We have, how many times do we have you scheduled? Yeah, we coming back. Wait, so this was one, you're coming back four? Sweet, all right. Okay, so, but yeah, people just assume, and we want to keep it that way, because another local pastor, if you remember me telling this story, he judged us in the past, and then I finally met with him, because we had to go pick up some food, and we sat there, and first he was real standoffish, and he was, we were speaking for like 30 minutes, and you could tell his body language changed, he was being more welcoming and opening, and then he goes, you know, man, you know, seriously, you might want to tell the other pastors and churches around here a little more about what you're truly about. Because, man, I really think they got the wrong idea about you. And I just looked at him and went, nope, nope. And he goes, wait, no? You don't want them to know? I go, no. I was like, because just the name of our church alone is Pharisee repellent. And a Pharisee won't even step foot on the yard, let alone walk in. And we want to keep it that way because I need to protect the first-time Christians, the baby Christians, the people that have made their way back to Jesus after a horrible experience with Christians or a church or a certain denomination. I got to protect them from those people. All right, so we don't even let them continue to go to their church. I'm not saying they're not saved. I'm not saying anything like that. But we are searching for lost people, and we don't want to scare the fish away. And he got it. And he got it, you know, and that was cool. So Ephesians 6:10-20 reads, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of the dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. And it sounds awesome, doesn't it? I mean, it really does. But what does it truly mean? And seriously, I'm just going to be transparent. What does it really mean? I mean, think about it. How in the heck are you supposed to put on military armor that you cannot see to fight an enemy that you cannot see and then going through life's bullcrap? You know, I mean, really, have anybody ever wondered that before? Am I the only one, or are you guys all Bible scholars out there? Because I don't buy it. I've sat through a lot of Armor of God messages. I've done a couple in the past 10 and a half years. And how are you really supposed to do that? So many people say, well, you have to armor up. I've had that told to me going through a bad week. Armor up, gotta armor up. And I don't believe they really understand what they're saying. I think it's a Christianese, one of those, God bless you, I'll pray for you. And you know they don't. Some people do, but they've done a study on that. There's a lot of, I'll pray for you. And then that prayer is probably like, Father, please bless them. Amen. Hey, order some pizza and never think about it again. That's why 9 times out of 10, if you ask me to pray for you, I'll write you back and say, I'm praying for you right now. And I do, right then and there, because I know I'll forget if I get sidetracked and then I've lied to you. Unmeaningly, or that's not a word. Don't judge me, Scott, okay? Whew. I get paranoid and self-conscious when we have a teacher in the house. A friend. But yeah, that's, armor up, you know. I'm depressed. Gotta armor up. My marriage is failing. Gotta armor up, brother. Can't have any chink in your armor. You know, and it's just like it becomes, seriously, I can't stand Christianese. It's like people walk in the door and they start speaking a different language when they come to church, and that has to be so intimidating for lost people. Like, what the hell are they saying? You know what I mean? Armor up! I hate to say it, but I fear that most Christians have not a clue what they are saying when trying to explain the full armor of God, let alone tell somebody how to actually use it. And armor up. Well, I believe God has given me the answer, okay? I really do. And it's a scary answer, and it's kind of like a kick in the crotch answer. And it's like everybody go womp womp womp. I really believe with all of my heart, man. So buckle up, Dorothy, and pray that, you know, I pray right now that the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart. For whom the bell tolls. One of you guys got left your phone on. All right. That's all right. It'll be advertised on eBay tonight. No, I'm kidding. Don't worry about it if it rings. It's all right. Well, I believe God has given me the answer. After looking at my notes from the last couple of times that I've done this in 10 years and 7 months, and I hate to say it, but I was doing research on the topic and reading tons of articles from everyone else across the, you know, and writing down my own thing. I mean, the first time I did this, here's the cool thing. The first time I did this message was 10 years ago today. Yesterday. It was 10 years ago yesterday that I did this message, and I was going through the notes. And it's like, it's not going to be the message that I'm going to do today. Because again, I remember I was studying, I was Googling, I was, you know, reading the word and doing all this kind of stuff. And I'll just be straight up transparent right now. Everybody stare at him. Where are you going? Where are you going, Vince Neil? Kickstart my heart. They ain't ever coming back. They said, well, we're going to play here four more times. And when they leave, they're like, we ain't going back to that damn place. Ain't no way. That guy crazy. He crazy. Hey, what's up, buddy? Oh, it's up here. Everybody give that man a round of applause. I'm kidding, Stinky. All right. That was funny. All right, so seriously, let's just go back. I look back at these messages that I did, and I'm not happy. Now, did I give you truth? Absolutely. Absolutely, I gave you truth. And would you kick John in the face? Now, this is too much distraction, John. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Spiritual warfare, you see what I'm saying? Ha ha! I love you, Rick. Let's start over. Stinky, I'm totally kidding, okay? But then I look over and John's over there. Thank you. All right, armor up. Say armor up. And again, I believe God has given me the answer. And looking at my nose from the last couple of times I've done this in the past 10.7 years, I hate to say it, but I was doing research on the topic and reading tons of articles from great names, you know, pastors and commentaries, but I would still walk away as if I truly failed to explain it. You know, we got the armor of God. Yeah, you know, go through all the parts, tell what they're about. We got to armor up, okay? But this one's different this time. Now, don't get me wrong. People would come up and say, man, thank you for that, Pastor B. I really needed that today. And like I said, it's sound doctrine, but there's just something deeper to it. Because I walk off like, how do I tell these people how to use this? And I was still seeking an answer I couldn't find. And I will ask it again. How in the heck are you supposed to put on military armor that you cannot see to fight an enemy that you cannot see while facing real world problems and mental illnesses and family and divorce and disease and death and all of this stuff that we have to go through? How are you supposed to use this armor? Well, today we are starting with the belt of truth. And I'm going to explain it the way that God showed me in only the past 24 hours. And it's cutting it close because what I said during service last week at the end, I said, I'm going to show you how to use this armor. And then I walked out of here like, shoo-wee, God. I really hope that was you telling me to say that, not just some wishful thinking on my end, or it's going to be a little awkward next Sunday. All right? And God always shows up. He always shows up on time, even when it's not our time, and even when it's down just to the last day, and I'm like, you know? I mean, what am I going to do, come out here and do the same? No, he showed up, and it started yesterday morning. And 24 hours before I'm supposed to be standing up here, I started to get the answer. Now, let's go ahead. Webster's Dictionary defines truth as the true or actual state of a matter. He tried to find out the truth. Conformity with fact or reality, verity, the truth of a statement, a verified or indisputable fact, proposition, principle, or the like, you know, the mathematic truths, 2 + 2 = 4. There is no other answer. That is the truth right there. So now it's verified. It's a fact. There's no way around it. And the state or character of being true, in truth, in reality, in fact, actually. Now, they say there's actually three sides to every story. Your side, your opponent's side, and the actual, factual, unbiased, unswayed truth. And that's why marriage counseling is needed, judges, mediators, and such, because we all tend to speak a truth that makes ourselves appear to be more of a victim than the other person, or that we've got. I mean, we're all guilty of it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you don't really focus and try to tell the actual factual truth, it's always going to lean our way. Everybody's been guilty of that at some point in their life, right? If you, anybody, everybody, yeah. Because if you say no, I'll call you liars, and we're preaching on truth today. So what does that tell you? Well, I only did that because he did this kind of mentality. Well, I only did to justify actions. I only did that because he made me do this. I only cheated on him because he was always out of town working and leaving me all alone. Or flip it, you know. In truth, though, listen. In truth, moral decay hastened the decline of the Roman Empire. Now, the Roman Empire began to trade truth for lies, all right? They began to call good evil and evil good. And isn't it amazing that a lot of these lies have to do with sexuality and sexual immorality? That was the final straw for Sodom and Gomorrah and the final straw for the Roman Empire. America is there now. But I hate to say it, we're even worse. And think about it. It took the Roman Empire 1,000 years to let moral decay destroy them. And America, who wants to be first and the best at everything, we've achieved it in only 244 years. All right? The U.S. is the largest distributor of porn in the world. We are responsible for 60% of all the porn in the world. 2 out of 3 porn sites in the entire world are hosted in California. And America has 4.2 million domains containing porn. Now, we were one nation under God. I don't believe we are anymore because Christians got lazy, got complacent, and started to just turn a blind eye to let this stuff happen. And I've said enough on that. 66.7% of Americans are out of shape and overweight. Now, I'm guilty as charged. Okay, I was back there like, man, this shirt, I can see my gut and all that. My girlfriend's like, you look fine. I wouldn't let you go out there, you know. And I'm like, I know, but I just feel it. I see it. But yet I'm too lazy to get out and do what I got to do to make it go away. And I just blame it on, well, I'm 50. I'm 50 and I'm cool. I can still run around stage and stuff. But listen, 66.7% of Americans are out of shape and overweight. And processed foods, high fructose corn syrup, and grease are the culprits. And we've sacrificed our health for quick and easy, which really equals laziness. It Satan gives us so much to do, so many choices, jobs that consume our days, our lives away, to come home and flip on the TV and pop something in the microwave or stop by Max Slappo's on the way home, or, you know, my favorite is pizza and Taco Bell. Man, but that's the healthiest of all the fast food out there. Come on now. You can't really jack up cheese and lettuce and beans and Class F meat. But it is Class F meat. Somebody worked there and said, you know, I saw this box and it said beef Class F. How do you feel about that, Brian? Well, I'd eat a turd sandwich if it was seasoned right. Seriously, if I found out that Taco Bell Class F beef was actually cow turds seasoned, I would not stop. Don't judge me. America, it tastes good. It's yummy goodness. But anyway, but seriously though, we are cashing in our health, our children's health. Our little baby girls are developing now earlier than they ever have because of this garbage, this process. We're eating fake food. You know what I'm saying? And it's unhealthy. My great-grandfather, G.V., who lived to be 105 years old, worked his butt off every day at his lumber mill. He ate sausage, biscuits and gravy, eggs, all of that stuff every day of his life, but worked it out of his system and lived to be 105. We eat fake food, and we are sloth-like. I sit behind a computer. I drive a bus. That's my job. The exercise that I get is walking the aisles of Sam's Club, which, hey, that's a big building. Shut up, all right? I do jump around like, you know, whatever at my shows. I mean, I burn up a lot of energy at the shows, and singing does take, you know, when I quit singing for a few years, I gained 15 pounds, man, like in my gut from not working those diaphragm muscles anymore. But part of the armor of God is described by Paul as the belt of truth, But what good is a belt? I mean, how are you going to use a belt of truth? I, you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's, and more importantly, what does it have to do with truth? I mean, let's just break this down a little bit. For starters, the average person, all of you, and I'm going to prove you wrong, okay? And if you can prove me wrong, please write me, because I'm going to say you're full of crap. Because I do this. I tried to be very aware of it years ago, and then I found myself, well, dang, I'm doing that all the time too now. You know, I'm transparent, man. I'll tell you my downfalls, all right? And I'm no better than you just because I'm standing up here. And the average person tells one or two lies per day, and that includes Christians. And some of you are like, what you thinking? No, he's wrong, yo. Not me. And I'm going to say bull crap because let me prove it. So, hey, man, how are you doing today? Great, just great. Actually, I just saw a 12-year-old on life support and had to pray over him with the parents bawling their eyes out. I'm great, man. Yeah, good to see you. No, it's really not good to see you. I can't stand you. Somebody said all the time. Yep. And that's why I will sometimes just say, when somebody comes up and says, hey, how you doing? I'll just say something meaningless. Hey, Brian, how you doing? I'm styling, profiling, and GQ fresh, hookah. Well, I didn't lie. I didn't mean to say that. That was cocky and conceited, but no. It's a joke, you know, so I dodged the bullet is what I'm saying. Or sometimes I'll say, you know, smile and say, partly cloudy with the chance of rain. How you doing, man? You know, because seriously, if you think about it, I'm not okay. And if I sit here and tell everybody, hey, man, I'm fine. I'm great. How you doing? I'm best. Yeah, you know, I'm lying. Just to pacify and to get this person to shut up. Not you. You say it to people that, well, some of you. But I'm not lying. You say it to the clerk at Speedway. You say it to the aunt or uncle that you can't stand. You say it to whatever. You know I'm telling the truth. And, you know, it's like you feel like you dodged a bullet. But so, hey, what did you think of my world-class chili that I've been bragging about for a month? Oh, my gosh, dude, it was awesome. Then you get in the car and say to your wife, that sucked. Man, did you taste the grease in that? I kind of threw up my mouth a little bit, man. Yuck. I mean, seriously, think about it. That is the one thing this world lacks is truth. We all lie. Every single one of us in this room lie. We're liars. It's so easy to lie. You don't have, that's the one thing, you know, we're born into sin. You don't have to teach a child to lie. John, did you get into that cookie jar? Nope. Chocolate all over his face. And nuh-uh, mom and daddy. What's all over your face? You know, you don't have to teach a child to lie. We lie every day. We lie to ourselves. We lie to others, sometimes boldly, or other times we just justify it by calling white lies, but white lies are lies. They are lies, okay? I do it all the time. I do. I was more conscious about it a few years back. And then, again, I get so much stuff dumped on me. You know, I see, again, we were talking about the music. I don't want to tell somebody that their music that they think is just so amazing sucks. And it does. But I don't want to tell them that because they're proud of it. Not you guys, because you guys rock, okay? No, seriously, you wouldn't be here 5-4 times if you didn't rock. But anyway, but seriously, white lies are still lies. And we all do it. How can the world tell us apart when we lie as much as they do? For real, man, we lie. And please tell me, if one of you right now can honestly say that you don't lie, please, I beg you to raise your hand. So I can kick you out because you're lying. If you truly were wearing the belt of truth, you would never lie no matter how hard the truth was to say. Right? For real, right? I want you to meet me halfway here. That's the truth. If you had the belt of truth on for real, you wouldn't lie. I could stop right now and we could all go home and you guys could regurgitate that and chomp on it for a whole week. but I won't do that to you. But we are all liars. People, I know Christians, past, present, well, not present, past, I shouldn't say stuff like that. And then people's going to say, man, is he talking about us? You know, like that. But no, I'm serious. I've seen it for years. Even before this church, I knew Christians that try to cheat workman's comp, unemployment. You know, I was tested by God, because when I lost my career the day after I started this place, my unemployment was about to run out after the year mark. And all I had to do was tell one little white lie on that unemployment paper, and I could have continued on with like 6 more months of benefits. Now, I've told you this church was the ultimate test of my faith ever in my life. Stepping out of the boat, losing my career, had another job lined up that was better than my career, and then God told me not to take it, to rely on him. So then here comes a year and unemployment's running out, and all I have to do is just say I went here, 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 and here, put down some numbers. I'll be okay for another 6 months, and God convicted my heart again. And I'm like, oh no. And another line in the sand, another I had to choose, because I guarantee if I chose wrong, Heavy Metal Church wouldn't have made it. And I had to choose to call unemployment and say, I don't want your money anymore, I'm good. Man, that was scary. And that's finally when God got my heart to the place where, all right, God, I know this is of you. I know it. Nobody can tell me any different. Heavy Metal Church is from you. I'm ready to lose everything I own and live in that little black short bus. And it was the most freeing thing in the world to not care about your bank account anymore and your house and, you know, just screw it. It was the ultimate screw it. I know this is God and he's going to take care of me. But remember, and that's why I always say, you know, people get so mad. Well, I thought God's going to put a roof over, you know, he's going to feed me, clothe me, and shelter me. The average American thinks that's translated in Hebrew to 3,000 square feet, designer jeans, and filet mignon. No, it could be in a little black short bus with ramen noodles and Goodwill clothes. And he has fed you, clothed you, and sheltered you. But we're spoiled friggin' brats. Christians that, you know, again, that can work and they don't. Christians that screw over the IRS every chance. They suck. I can't stand the IRS. They're robbing us. But we're still supposed to follow the law. You know, tacking 30 minutes on taking a dump every day at work for 30 minutes. You know, now some of you does take 30 minutes, but most of us don't. You're robbing the company. That's lying. No, it's not. Yes, it is. It is. Poop and get out of there. And if you smartened up and got a bidet like I've got, you could pump and dump in like 3 minutes and be done. Bidet life, ladies and gentlemen. I feel like primitive when I have to use somebody else's toilet now. Listen. Joe Christian and his lovely wife, Lisa, were just calling each other every name in the book. They were having a huge fight just minutes before walking in the church doors. Joe's drinking problem and Lisa's flirting on Facebook is causing severe damage in their marriage. Joe hides his drinking problem from church family because he fears judgment from these church people. Not church people. Lisa's miserable thinking the grass is greener somewhere else and gets the attention from others that she feels that she is not getting at home. Lisa flirts because Joe is always hammered, and Joe is always hammered because Lisa flirts. They walk into church with their Windex smiles on. The door greeter says, "Hello, Joe and Lisa, how are you doing today? Praise God." And they respond with, "Praise God, brother, never better. Life is so grand, isn't it? God is good all the time." Hate Christianese. Joe and Lisa walk away and the door greeter's thinking, man, I wish my life was as perfect as Joe and Lisa's. man, my marriage sucks, and I'm barely making ends meet. They're probably better Christians than me. I wish I was a better Christian. And that's the mentality when people go to church. This is supposed to be the place that we're supposed to confess our sins and struggles to one another. And then you piss somebody off and have just a disagreement in a couple of months, and they're out slinging and backslabbing, and that's not Christ-like. And when you break your covenant with somebody that you told you would, you could be confided in, you're lying. You don't have the belt of truth. Deception is all around us on TV. We can't trust our news. I never knew that until the last 5 years. We can't even trust our own news. There's deception at the workplace. Salesmen. I had a salesman. And if you're a Christian salesman, it's not okay to lie because it's your job. You know that motor coach? I was in Richmond, Indiana, trying to go to Tom Raper, and I didn't know that. Well, I won't say it. I could get sued. But a certain place, you know, and they tried to get us for $14,000 more on the same coach that I got at Paul Sherry, and then tried to say, oh, no, we can't go any lower. And I was like, for real? And this is great. I've gotten so bold and just don't give a crap anymore. Hold on just 1 minute. And I picked up the phone and called Paul Sherry right in front of this salesman. I said, hey, man, I could have swore I saw a 2020 Thor 33.5 feet pop-out motor coach in an ad, and you wanted $99.5 for it. Is that true? Oh, yeah, we sold that one, though. And I'm like, but we got one for $101,000. Are you serious? $101,000 right now. And I looked at the... You know, and I'm like, really? Okay, well, I'm going to come down and get it, more than likely. So I got off the phone. Sir, now, listen, and I believe the guy. He goes, that's why I hate this job. They don't tell us what that. I was just told that we can't go any lower than that. And then here comes the manager. He goes and gets the manager. I'm trying to get out of there. Sir, I heard what happened. What's it going to take for you to drive home in that Thor today? I'm like, well, first of all, you pissed me off because you lied to me. Now, sir. I'm like, no. I was like, I'm mad. I just asked to come down, and you're saying no, and I can get it for $14,000 cheaper. No, man, that's wrong. Well, sir, we just had a used one come in that's only a year old. I can give you that for $89.5. Does it come with the warranties? Well, I'll see what I can do. Got in, went straight to Paul Sherry, wrote a check for $46,000 down. The rest is history, all right? But they lied. So if you're a Christian and you've got a job where you're required to lie, that's not okay. God is not okay with that. So deception, it's all around us, and it's become a way of life. Friends, family, and every other category that you can think of, we are all two-faced in some way, shape, or form to somebody. Am I right? I mean, Scott, I'm sure you don't love everybody you work with. I don't love everybody we work with. I love their souls, but you kind of want to throat punch them sometimes, right? So, you know, it's like we're all two-faced to some period, and the only pure truth on earth is the Word of God. And Jesus, that's it. We are flawed. We are so flawed, man, and that's why I don't understand self-righteous Christians that think they're better than everybody, because we're not. If they really look behind in the eyes, in their own mirrors. And if I brought this, you lie. You're a liar. You can't have the belt of truth if you can keep lying and not even realize it. Today's message is to wake you up and to let you start realizing that we lie on a daily basis. Therefore, we can have no belt of truth to fight this stuff, because we're not even trying not to lie. The more we saturate our minds with the truth, the more we shall speak the truth. Do these jeans make my butt look fat? The answer is you shouldn't ask it, or you wouldn't ask it, if you didn't know it was already fat. I don't need to ask somebody if I've gotten a gut in the past 6 months. I know. I vowed that I wasn't going to gain love fat. I fell in love, and here comes the weight. How does that work? I didn't say answer it. But seriously, I mean, let's really talk about it. And I am not trying to, but we're wanting to seek truth, right? The only reason you would ask somebody if those jeans make your butt look big is because you've got a big butt. You're hoping the jeans will camouflage that ass. That's what you're really asking, right? Do these jeans make my big butt look smaller? Start asking that. At least you're being truthful. And then as a dude, we won't feel like we're getting ready to get throat punched if we answer correctly. But seriously, though, I know that's funny, but it's the truth. It is the truth. Why else would you ask somebody that? Because you want your ego stroked. You want to feel attractive. We all want to feel attractive, but I don't want to be lied to so that I can have some false security. You see what I'm saying? Am I right? Honey, am I balding? Of course you are balding. Go grab a picture from just a few years ago, stud. But you still look great, but of course your hair's thinning out. You're in your 50s. You can't be Goldilocks forever. Not everybody's like Alice Cooper, who rocks. Do you like this blouse on me? No, actually I don't. I don't like the color, but if you like it, that's all that matters. Instead of saying, oh yeah, man, that looks great. You're lying. But be nice about it. Hey man, do you like the shirt? Actually, it doesn't appeal to me. You know, I don't like the ruffle thing and all that kind of stuff, but don't ask me. I'm just giving you my opinion, which don't mean nothing, but you ask. But the funny thing is, people will ask, and if you don't give them the answer that they want to hear, they get mad. We are screwed. We're only to part of the armor number one, and we all fail. And we wonder why we get our butts kicked by the enemy. This is what God revealed to me. Listen, if you spend your life telling white lies all the time, we have allowed Satan to get that steel-toe boot in the door, and in time, your white lies are going to start getting a little darker. Because that's how it all starts. It's just innocent. It just feels good. The Bible even says sin is awesome for a short period of time. That's a paraphrase, of course. But it does. What's the exact word? Sin is, Bo, you remember that one? Sin is pleasurable for a season. I translate that in, yeah, sin can really be awesome for a short period of time. And then, bam, it gets its meat hook snares in you. Here's one. Hey, man, dude, what do you think of my new tattoo? Ladies and gentlemen, if I've taught you anything in 10.7 years, a cheap tattoo is not good, and a good tattoo is not cheap. All right? So when you come up and you're like, hey, look at this, man. What'd you think? Well, I've had to lie so many times, but I need to start saying if it sucks, it really doesn't appeal to me, so I'm actually the wrong person to ask. Instead of, dude, that rocks, man. And I'm thinking, oh, you poor, poor person. I mean, not poor like in financial. I'm saying like, and you know, it's, anyway, I won't tell the story because I just keep going off. I got a great tattoo story, but never mind. For you first timers, I used to say amen while I get a drink, and it just stuck. So now they're like, yeah. So yeah, tattoo. I've been guilty of that so many times. And just like I admitted last week about all the original music that gets thrown at me in the past decade. And from here on out, I'm just going to start saying, you know, I don't like screamo music. I don't. I like the music. I'm a vocalist, man. I mean, Chris Cornell, Robert Plant, all that. Those are my heroes. And Cookie, I know it takes talent. Cookie, I call them Cookie Monster vocals. Cookie. And they can really sing. I mean, I do like a couple of Lamb of God songs. I do, you know, whatever. But I don't like that style. But to avoid hurting somebody's feelings, oh, man, dude. But what I really should say is, you know, really, it's I don't care for that that vocal style. The music sounded great. Or, well, it really wasn't my cup of tea, but I'm probably the wrong person to ask because I'm pretty set in my musical tastes. That's true. And that's nice. And it's not a lie. And if somebody wants to get ticked at me for that, go get butt hurt somewhere else, man, because we're supposed to be people of truth. And I would rather have the truth that hurts my feelings a little bit than to be lied to just so I can live a lie. You're living a lie if you get mad when somebody tells you the truth that you don't want to hear. That's not the belt of truth. That's not even close. Stop lying. Be nice, but stop lying. Today, start being conscious. We all need to start being conscious about white lies and about whatever. One of the reasons I have a lot of haters is because I will point blank tell you the truth in a lot of things. Now, I am weak when it comes to somebody's music or tattoos or, you know, something like that. But I got a lot of haters because I'll just tell them what time of day it is. And they hate that. And even Christians will hate you for it. You know, like, I hate to bring it back up, but like, you know, that video I posted, the guy that was slamming us, everybody knows him. I won't even say his name, but, you know, I was called out. Well, yeah, you said something about Twinkie and the nap, you know? And the reason why I did, I'll admit, I lashed out way too hard because when he pulled that daughter thing that I told you about, I think it was last week, and bringing up my dead dad and just being real malicious, you know? And it's like, I'm getting attacked because I'm being told I'm going to go to hell for smoking a cigar, which you can't find that in the Bible, but they all want to put, well, you know, it's God's temple, man. You're hurting the temple. But you are, and that's where the Twinkies come in, you know? It's like, you're so out of shape and you're obese and you've got diabetes as a result of laziness and obesity. And you're going to tell me about my temple? Yeah, go grab another box of Twinkies and take a nap. It was the truth. And some hard truth that, whatever, but I shouldn't have said it like that. I made a mistake, but I'm human. And I'm not perfect. And just because if you tick me off, I can go from zero to pissed in 10 minutes or 10 seconds. What am I talking about? A lot quicker than that. 10 seconds. And that's what happened when you start talking about my daughter like that, you know? I even apologized, like yesterday, and it don't matter. He's a vendetta. I'm going to hell. I'm a cult leader. I'm this and this, and all you people are following me to hell, and over a cigar? I don't get the mentality of people that serve the same God as I do, and I'm not perfect, but dang. Oh, I was going to say something else. Well, no. People can't handle the truth. This is going to be graphic. Oh, that's another thing too. Oh man, what time is it? Here we go, man. Huh? Oh man, we got tons of time. So is anybody bored? If you're bored for this message, at this message, this church ain't for you, man. Because there's nothing boring about this. It's truth. And this is going to be graphic, but you know, TJ and I mean, we finally got sick of street preachers and got sick of even this guy we were just talking about. And, you know, because they come across, I can't stand self-righteous Christians, man. They come across like the street preachers have told us before that they don't sin anymore, ever. Now, first of all, my Bible says they're called a liar because we all screw up. I just proved it today. All of you are liars. We are. So, but this guy was adamant that no, there is no, I was like, man, when's the last time you ever screwed up or made a, I can't remember. I've been cleansed by the blood and I am sanctified and I just don't have the desire to sin anymore. Right? Well, TJ found out some great information. And I told this story before, but I'm going to tell it again because it's hilarious. And so we found out that this guy is separated from his wife. Well, you know, when you open that can of sexual worms, you can't close it. So TJ just looked at him in the face and said, well, I'll use a different word, but said, hey, man, I heard about you and your wife being separated. So how many times do you pleasure yourself in a month? His jaw. Like that, what happened? He couldn't say a word, and he turned around and walked off. Busted! You know what I'm saying? And I busted the other guy I was just talking about. I won't get into that. But that's what we say now when we find self-righteous people that are either widowed, divorced, and all that stuff, and they call themselves Christians, and they're coming at us. They don't expect that question to be asked because that's taboo. But it's real life. All right? And you bring it up, and oh, this is great. You feeling us? You see what I mean? Anybody shocked? You shouldn't be, because this is real life. Just like that video I posted that I kind of got some flack for. I'm trying to bring awareness to the lost people of the world that not all Christians are psycho weirdo freak shows. Self-right. There was this video of a real church service that this woman's up there. Oh, and a demon had sex with me. And blah, 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 blah. And basically what it is she just gets tempted and keeps having sex with people. And she comes to church calling it a demon. And then the pastor comes up, you oral sexual demon, boom, and starts, saying some weird stuff. And it's a real video. And we wonder why people don't want to go to church or want anything to do with Jesus. Because if I was sitting in that church for the first time, I would have got up, where's the water fountain? Who would want anything to do? If they were truly representing the one true God, the creator of the universe, who would want anything to do with that freak show? So I post it because it's real. And I even say rated R, and and people come at me, man, I can't believe you posted that. That's dirty. It's real life that's happening in our world. I'm not trying to be dirty. I'm not trying to be, I do try to push the envelope with some of these goody-two-shoe people, but that's real life. Why am I going to not say, hey, look at this. This ain't real Jesus right here. This is fake. This is a military genius. His name's Satan, trying to make the one true God look like his followers are a bunch of idiots. Because that's what you see. The rest of the world ain't going to see a message like this, maybe a few thousand from Facebook or something, but not the whole world. This is the message the whole world needs to see, not this woman who just apparently likes to have sex and then feels guilty about it and gets convicted and then comes in, a demon had sex with me this weekend. Watch the video, please. It's very disturbing but entertaining. The belt of truth. I used to start with the helmet of salvation because in the past on my other messages, because I thought it actually all started there. But then it hit me yesterday, here I'm trying to tell the Bible they got it wrong. And but what I'm saying, it starts with the belt of truth. I'm not thinking the Bible's wrong, but I always wondered, why do they start with the belt of truth? Because it starts with salvation. You know what I'm saying? That kind of makes sense. It starts with salvation, so I just always start there. And, where we go? Helmet of salvation, but I thought it was actually all started there. But then it hit me yesterday. There's so many lies out there, and Satan has filled this world with deception. He has filled the world with false gods and false religions. There's false Christian denominations out there. Look, my best friend's a Mormon, but it's a false doctrine. They don't preach that Jesus is God in human form, that it was God. It's the Son of God, it's the Trinity, it's confusing to wrap your mind around, but they'll tell you that, Jesus was a good man that became God, and that we're all going to become God someday, of our own planets, and have celestial children with, no, the Bible don't say that. And then Jehovah's Witness. They don't believe that Jesus was God in human form or that Jesus is part of the Trinity and all that. They think he was just a good man. And it was the greatest death of all time. That's false doctrine, but both of them call themselves a Christian denomination. And many are deceived. I don't hate them. Jehovah's Witness are some of the nicest people I ever met until you tell them at the door, you tell me your story and let me tell you why, you know, mine. Oh, no, we don't want. I was like, well, then that's not fair. Bye. You know, whatever. But listen, when the Holy Spirit calls you to him, it starts with you accepting the 100% truth that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died in your place on the cross, and he rose from the dead 3 days later. Jesus is the only way to God and heaven, and he is coming back again someday. And without believing that truth and confessing that first, there is no salvation. That's why the belt of truth is first. Because there's so much deception and lies out there, you have to accept the truth. When the Holy Spirit captures your heart, you have a decision to make, and you have to accept that truth. The first piece of armor Paul mentions in Ephesians 6:14 is the belt of truth. What purpose did the belt serve for a Roman soldier? What purpose does the belt of truth serve for us? Discovery Channel's Mythbusters interviewed Deputy Sean Osborne, whose standard-issue belt buckle deflected a bullet at close range, saving his life. In spite of a big bruise, Deputy Osborne knew he was very lucky. Belt buckles are not designed to stop bullets, but there was a time when belts were an important part of defensive armor, and I didn't know this. Are you girded with truth? I'm asking you, Heavy Metal Church, are you truly girded with truth? When the Apostle Paul describes the armor of God, he is talking about more than a simple set of helpful tips. He is talking about the impregnable defenses of our Almighty God. These are keys to withstanding the attacks and onslaughts of the great dragon of old, Satan the devil. There are ultimate and infinitely powerful tools available to us as Christians. And remember, Satan is not messed. Now, this is a hard one for some of you to swallow, but it's the truth, and it hurts. But Satan is not messing with you if you are not a threat. I got to get that through your heads. If you're not a threat, if you're not trying to apply God's word to your daily lives and trying to add fresh ink in the Lamb's book of life, these so-called attacks you are facing is nothing more than the imperfections of life itself because of a fallen world. But if you are all in and trying your best, or trying your best to be all in, then the enemy is going to come at you full force. Excuse me. Because you have become a real threat. He can't hurt God physically. He can't beat God at anything. But he figured out how to pierce God's heart and hurt God emotionally. And that's taken as many humans as he can to his fate, his hell, that wasn't designed or made for us. Satan found a loophole, and then God had the ultimate fix with Jesus Christ. Was it a surprise to God that all that was going to happen? No. But to get to us, to get us to the original creation that he had designed, we had to go through all of this, and in the end, his sheep will be with him forever and ever. Whew. And remember, okay, here's the deal. I've said it before in many messages. Everybody agrees, right? Everybody in this room, me and you alike, has that one thing that seems to trip you up every time. That one flavor of sin, if you want to call it, that one thing that Satan uses more than anything to you know, cause you to stumble and fall. Well, listen to me very carefully. When you start to get all in and you start to take the Bible serious and just try to apply it to your lives and try to serve God, whatever weakness you have, he will focus on that for the rest of your life. Absolutely. Now, Do atheists and agnostics struggle with porn? Absolutely. It's a fallen world. It doesn't matter whether you're saved or lost. We're all jacked up. But the thing is, when you're trying to serve God and make disciples of all men, that he's going to shove salt in that wound every chance he can get, and he's going to focus on that for the rest of your life. If you suffer from depression, he's going to amplify it. That's what happened to me. I hit the lowest of low I ever had ever in my life and wanted to die. Why? Because Satan knew he could just sit there and peck, and had the right people, the right places, the right things to just keep shoveling my way to just break me down. And that's what he's going to do with you when you finally take God serious. That's why those pastors, oh, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. He's going to answer all of your problems, and life's going to be great, and you guys are going to walk off in the sunset hand in hand eating Twinkies and hot chocolate. No, that's the biggest lie in the world. Because if you're taking God serious, Satan's going to start taking you serious. And that's when the fun begins. Whatever weakness you have, he's going to focus on it. If you struggle with anxiety, anger, and gossip, check this out. God put this on my heart this morning. So here's an example. If you struggle, if your struggles are anxiety, anger, and gossip, he will cause you to think that somebody over in this section is talking smack about you, and you will get angry, then go gossip about it to somebody over here. See what I'm saying? Because he knows you're a hothead, he knows you're a gossip, and he knows that you suffer from anxiety where you don't even want to walk into rooms with people in it. So he's going to play on that to keep you out of here. Anybody here suffer from anxiety? I used to play tricks all the time. I would either be the first to show up, no, that was it, or wait till the lights are off and then walk in the dark. But the first to show up, because it hit me. That's where my anxiety to come in was, walking into a crowded room and everybody looking at you. But if you're the first one there, you can look at them when they walk in. So see, it's self-medicating, man, trying to figure yourself out. Satan will play on that. As a pastor, I used to purposely do all my lunch meetings and dinner meetings on off hours because I didn't want to deal with these big crowds of people and everybody that knows me. Hey, Brian, hey. And I'm like, sensory overload. I'm not like that anymore. It's like, come on, player. God healed me. But if you struggle with lust, there will always be something in your path to lust after. If you struggle with fits of rage, there will always be someone placed in your path that pisses you off. Trust me. Do atheists struggle with porn? Absolutely. But most atheists don't think it is wrong, but you know it is. And now, if you're trying to correct it, you will all of a sudden have more opportunities to fail. That's how the enemy works. Get the software and find an accountability partner. Quit cowering and fight it. You may lose some battles. You're going to win some battles. But don't stop fighting. Don't give in. Keep fighting. I love that one picture of the frog that's holding on to the pelican's neck. And the pelican has the frog's head in his mouth. And the thing says, never give up. It's like, I love that. And no, for us, never give up. I've been totally transparent about the past 2.5 years after my divorce. Man, it's been hell. You know what I'm saying? And you never stop fighting. You never stop trying to do the right thing. You're going to win and lose some, but don't stop trying. And those are just a couple of sins. There are about a billion other things that we all struggle with. I could go and everybody in this room, and if you were really, really honest with me, there's so many. A pastor I love and respect, I've told the story before. I was like, please tell me that you really are human and not perfect, because I think you're perfect, you know, and I know you're not, but you just appear, you know, there's one of those people that you just think's the perfect Christian. And I just praise God that he was transparent and honest with me. He goes, look, he goes, if I told you what my hang up was, you would probably go, oh, really? Oh, like that. And he goes, so no, I'm not perfect. And I was like, thank you for telling me that, though, because I struggle with crap all the time. So at least I know I'm in good company. Those are just a couple, man. There are about a billion other things. It all takes place on the battlefield. And if you haven't figured it out yet, that battlefield is your mind. Everything's in your mind. This is the most powerful thing. It can either be the greatest thing for you or the worst thing against you, man. And that song, Own Worst Enemy. I am my own worst enemy. I don't give a crap about my enemies. I'm enemy enough. I can bring myself into a bummer state of mind more than anybody else can. That is why reading your Bible is so important. The more you saturate your mind with God's word, the sharper it becomes to discern good from evil and the stronger you are to resist it. People say, is it a sin to watch horror movies and read romance novels? Listen, many pastors, here's the deal. Many pastors will just say, yes, right out of the starting gate. But I will say that if that is all you read and watch, okay, if that's all you read and watch with your time and only give God fragments of your time with your Bible study and prayer time, then yes, it's wrong. Straight up, it's wrong. I'm not saying it's wrong in a sense to watch horror movies. I like horror movies, a good horror movie, scary movie. There's some churches and pastors and Christians, that's the devil. It's the devil. You know, and it's like, that's your opinion, but anything that you put before God is wrong. Anything, rated G, if you watch too many rated G cartoons, then you spend seeking God or striving to get closer to God. Anything you do and give God the scraps is idolatry, and idolatry is a sin. All right? You will someday find that the more time you spend with God, the more time you saturate your mind with God, the more time you spend with seeking the truths of God, everything else will start taking a back seat. And it will just happen naturally. You won't even miss it. That's the greatness about God. You've got people, no, you got to give this stuff up. You know, as soon as you get saved, you got 1 week to just... That don't work because you're doing it in your own power. And then you're going to miss it. And then when you're having a bad day or your girl breaks up with you or your ex ticks you off and you can't get your kid or you lose your job or something like that, you're going to say, screw it, and crawl right back to it. There's some things you can, okay, if I wanted to quit chewing gum tomorrow, yeah, it'd suck, but I would win that one. I'd just start eating Lifesavers all the time. But there's things that are so entwined in you from years and years and years and years of doing it. I've told you, it's like a fish line in a knot. You can't get, only God can hotwire and rewire your mind and heart. You can be successful for a minute. There's agnostics that's been successful from heroin and all that. I get it. Atheists, whatever. But they don't have an enemy shoving that stuff because you're trying to better yourself and follow God's word. You really do have an enemy. Whatever it is that is your sin, that the heat's going to get turned up. But that's what's wrong with church is we truly are a come as you are place. Because when you give your heart to Jesus, man, that's you're a baby in Christ. If you walked in, I say it all the time, the regulars probably get sick of it. The first timers still laugh. But if you walked in here a douchebag today and you gave your heart to Jesus today, you're still going to walk out that door a douchebag. But you're going to be a saved douchebag. And now you're going in the undouching process. And only God can undouce you. You see what I'm saying? You can try to be less of a douche, but you're so much of a douche. You're a douche. But in time, you will go through the undouching process, and then somebody's going to come up and say, dang, you've changed. Well, what do you mean? You're not as big as a douche anymore. What happened? Well, Jesus Christ happened. What's that? Yeah, crap on a stick, man. People say, oh, sorry. You are, you spend time, okay, start taking back seat, okay, boom. What time is it, Pink? 1:48. You guys want me to keep going? I'd really like to get this done today. But I guess let's just see how far we get. Tell me when it's 2. I'm going to see where I'm at, and then I'm either going to bring the band up or finish, being where I'm at. So, now Paul chooses to begin describing this set of armor by talking about a belt. We're going to start off with a belt. Why of all things a belt? He could have started with the mighty sword of the Spirit, the towering shield of faith, the shining breastplate of righteousness, anything but some measly old belt. But he didn't. So that begs the question, why? Well, I gave you my rendition. I really believe that with all of my heart. And here's his. What was the belt used for in the Roman army? And when you listen to this, it makes so much sense now. The belt, known as the cingulum or balteus, played a crucial role in the effectiveness of a soldier's armor. And you're thinking, the belt? It was the belt that held the scabbard, without which there would be no place to put a sword. Imagine an overzealous soldier fired up and charging out into battle, but without his belt and consequently without a weapon. In addition, the Nelson Study Bible says, from the belt hung strips of leather to protect the lower body. The Matthew Henry commentary says that the belt secures all the other pieces of our armor. Truth should cleave to us as a belt cleaves to our body. And we just admitted we're all friggin' liars. How can we even begin to fight spiritual battles of darkness when we just all admitted to being liars? And it's not just you. It's every dang church in America. You see what I'm saying? You see how deceptive? You didn't even see that coming today, did you? You see how deceptive the enemy is. What is truth? John 17:17, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And I say, or at least it should be, or at least you should try very hard for it to be. Jesus praying to the Father gives a clear and straightforward definition of truth. God's word, the Holy Bible, scripture is the word of truth, was given by inspiration of God, 2 Timothy 3:16. The Greek expression translated inspiration of God literally means God breathed. He actively and fully inspired the Bible to reveal his truth to us. Then you've got the naysay, well, that Bible was written by man. Well, Quran. The Quran was written in like 24 years by one lunatic, all right? The Bible took like 1,500 or 1,600 years, 66 books by 44 different authors throughout a 1,500-year period that somehow coincidentally were finishing each other's sentences, and the people never even met each other, and they're from all different continents. Come on, man. What's the chances? What's the chances and the odds of that even being possible? And then what's the chances of this guy that shows up on the scene 400 years after the Old Testament? There's a 400 year silence between the Old Testament and the New Testament. Then all of a sudden this dude shows up and he just so happens to have fulfilled all 300 and some prophecies. Was there 300 and some? Something like that. But there was a lot, 300 and some prophecies in the Old Testament. He fulfilled every single one. And then if you did the statistics on that, I've said it before, that is like encircling the entire state of Texas with a 2-foot wall, just the perimeter of Texas with a 2-foot wall, filling it with white poker chips. And then and somewhere in the entire state of Texas, there's one red poker chip buried somewhere. And the probability of Jesus fulfilling all of those prophecies out of a book that took 1,500 years to write by all these different authors on all these different continents that never met each other, and it was just like they were finishing each other's sentence, would be like some dude, very lucky dude, walking into the state of Texas. Red. That's the odds. job, John. Oh, I think we'll stop there. Come on up. No, seriously, we're going to stop there. I'm not going to try. I've got, what time is it? Yeah, I've got too many pages. One, two, three, four, five. I've got five more pages. So I think that's a good place to stop. And we're going to pick up next week. And we're going to merge right into the next bit of armor. And that's how we're going to do it. Is everybody good with that? All right. So if you would please bow your heads, though, because I have to keep a promise to God. And again, and please, first, for our long-standing members here, don't ever get tired of this. For real, man. Because eternity is forever. And I feel bad for you if, oh, man, we got to set through another salvation prayer, man. This is eternity we're talking about. And I'm doing what God told me to do. So you be as zealous and as excited in hope that somebody will give their hearts to Christ, okay? And now if you'll bow your heads, but we have first timers here today. And I honestly, I don't know where you're at with God. And we get people all the time that have walked away from God and they spent years chasing their tail in the desert. And they, well, you know, I heard this heavy metal church thing. I just want to check it out. I really don't like church. I don't fit in at church. Well, it's no coincidence that you're here today. And God's not mad at you. He's there. And he just wants you to just repent, say you're sorry, and look back. He never left you. He's right there the whole time. He just wants you to start over with him. And then there's so many people we come across, and it's like you believe everything you need to believe to be saved. You believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he was here on earth, he walked the earth, that he was crucified, tortured, murdered on a cross in your place for your sins. And he was laid in a rich man's tomb that was loaned. And God raised him from the dead 3 days later. You believe that, but you've never been saved. Some people say, well, you know, I was baptized as a kid. You got to know what you were doing and why you were doing it. But you believe everything. And then other people, well, I'm not ready to quit this. And I know I got to quit that. And I was told I'm going to go to hell for this. You don't have to quit anything. God will clean you up along the way. You don't stop at the sink after working all day and wash your hands before you take a shower. He just wants you to jump in. Give your heart to Jesus. Get your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and he'll deal with the messes later. We just want to love the hell out of you every Sunday at noon and stay out of God's way during the cleanup process, but just love you as a brother and sister in Christ, not judge you. We're all jacked up. Even the pastor standing up here. I'm an evangelist, though. I'm still jacked up. We're going to say a prayer. Romans 10 says if you'll just confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That doesn't mean just, okay, God, I believe in you. Okay, good. Now I'm in. And then no, because if you're truly saved, you're going to feel somehow the Holy Spirit coming into your heart. You're going to, this is such a beautiful and intimate thing. It's not a few words to get your hell and her fire insurance or your get out of hell free card. That's not how it works. You're feeling the Holy Spirit right now call you to him. And he's been waiting on this day your entire life. I don't know how many times I should have died in my life and God kept me safe. It could be the same way for you because he knew this day was coming. If you're watching or listening today and this is, I'm talking about you, we're going to say a prayer right now. And if you mean the words with all of your heart, you will be saved. Your sins will be forgiven. And you're about to enter into an adventure with us, the misfits. And we're going to serve Lord Jesus with all of our hearts. If you'd like to be saved or if you'd like to rededicate your heart to Jesus, repeat this prayer with all of us because we're going to say it right along with you. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I confess now that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe with all of my heart that you raised him from the dead. Father, I confess that I'm a sinner. Please cover my sins with the blood of Jesus. I repent now. Give me the strength to change please clean me up along the way. I want to serve you and only you. You are my God. I am your child. And I mean this with all of my heart. And I ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. If you said that for the first time, your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life, written in blood. And nobody can ever take that out. Does it make you perfect? Oh, no, 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 no. But God will clean you up on the way. He is true and faithful. And you are now our brother and sister, whether you like it or not. Even John. So, I'm kidding. Guys, that was, thank you so much for coming here today. Invite somebody for next week. And just know, I love you guys. I'm glad we're all in this together. Keep this church and me and the leadership team and the pastors and everything about FHMCC in your daily prayers for protection and direction. And I mean, man, we got to keep moving full speed ahead and follow Jesus every step of the way, no matter how uncomfortable it gets, no matter what. We're in this together. Amen. All right. I'll see you. Well, you won't get. Wait, guys, you ready? You ready? You ready, Stinky? No, I can't do that to you. I'm talking, you rock, brother. What is your real name? Elliot. Elliot. Like E.T.? Nah, I'm gonna call you Vince. Vince. It's Vince.
I like Vince.
Vince. Guys, take care.
Yeah, don't go anywhere. We got two songs left here. Oh, you can leave if you have to. It's all good.
Everybody getting hungry.
Everybody getting hungry? It's been a pleasure to be here for our first time here. And well, thank you, thank you. We'll be back four more times, I guess, so, you know. Thanks to Rochelle and Steve here that hooked us up with them. You ready, Freddie? All right, let's do a couple more and rock out.
He's your friend.